transfer continues, which you will not understand unless you consider the phase equilibrium. Because in phase equilibrium, it is just not the concentration difference which governs the mass transfer. It is the difference in chemical potential, or in other words, we have defined it now in terms of difference in fugacity of any component between the two phases through across which mass transfer is occurring. So therefore, the problem of thermodynamics is that you need to evaluate certain quantities which most of us do not understand properly. Chemical potential is anyhow abstract. We have replaced it with fugacity. The only reason for replacing it was that we know fugacity, the value of fugacity under some standard conditions. What is the standard conditions under which we know the value of fugacity? Can you tell me?
Low pressure.
Low pressure. Under which any particular substance is in the gaseous state and the gas behaves as an ideal gas. So therefore, we have simply replaced chemical potential, something very abstract, with possibly you feel a more abstract quantity, but it is actually not so, because the fugacity is something which, the value of which we know at some particular pressure. So therefore, we can find it out at any other pressure, be it in any phase, in any form, in pure state, in mixture, in any particular form. Why? Because we know the fugacity of that particular component at very low pressure, where every particular component behaves as a gas. And if that component is in a pure state, then the fugacity is equal to the total pressure of the system. If it is in a mixture, then the fugacity of that component is equal to the, if it is in a mixture, then the fugacity of the component is equal to the, at low pressure,
partial pressure of the,
partial pressure of that particular component in that particular system. Now, thermodynamics, the basic problem which I have already told you, it's not the equations. The problem is all the equations are in terms of differences. You will find all the equations are in terms of D. So therefore, they evaluate the differences or the changes in properties. And therefore, if we have to know the absolute value of the properties, we need to know the value of the property under some particular condition. And we need to integrate all equations from that particular standard condition to the present condition where you wish to know it. So therefore, this is where the entire problem comes in thermodynamics. It's not the equations mainly, but it is that most of the equations are as differential equations. And since these are as differential equations, for getting the absolute values, we need to integrate these equations. Whenever we need to integrate, there are two things that we need to know. Firstly, we have some particular equality. So therefore, whenever we are integrating it, both the left-hand side and the right-hand side, all of these, they should correspond to one particular lower limit. The same lower limit has to be there, and the lower limit has to be selected very judiciously. Normally, when we are dealing with pure components, then normally the lower limit is some particular state where at least one property or more than one property of the component is known. Usually, since we know the properties in the ideal gas state, we start our integrations from P equals to zero. Now, when we are dealing with components in mixture, then we can either start from that particular pure component in an ideal gas mixture, that is, we can start from P equals to zero, or maybe there are situations where we integrate from the pure component state to the mixture state. It all depends on what we want to find out and what are the values that we need. This is the only thing which creates the added complexity in thermodynamics. Am I clear to you?
Yes, ma'am.
Then also it is difficult, I understand, isn't it? But remember one thing, thermodynamics is complicated. Just the equations you have everywhere. The problem of thermodynamics is all of these are differential equations. every single equation defines any particular property in terms of the differences, differential equations. So therefore, for getting the absolute value, they have to be integrated. Whenever you integrate, there are two things that you have to remember, and these two things are the standard state or the lower level of integral has to be same for each particular differential equation that you have, and this particular standard state has to be selected judiciously. It has to be something where at least one or more than one properties are known to you. There's one other advice which I'll give you. Never try to jump steps. If you think judiciously, you'll find that we use just the same equations that we had started in the beginning. For example, du equals to tds minus pdv. From this du, we came to dh, then we came to da, then we came to dg. Dg is the thing that we have started using maximum. What is dg equals to, tell me? Dg equals to?
Vdp minus sdt.
Minus sdt plus vdp. Perfect. And this particular molar g, we have defined it as chemical potential. So therefore, if it's a pure component, then the molar g is chemical potential of that component. When this same component is in the mixture, then the chemical potential of the component becomes the partial molar Gibbs free energy. And this is what has to be equal for each component in the different phases. Just to remember this thing, and remember one other equation, d mu equals to RT dln F. If you just remember these two, and if you do not try to jump steps and to define the lower limit of the integrals properly, you will find that you are not going to face any problem. What I advise is, when I derive the things, it will be good if you also start deriving them, and accordingly we can proceed. Then in that case, if I made a mistake or I have jumped any step, you can immediately catch hold of me so that we can come back and we can redefine it. It can always happen that maybe I jump some steps because I'm very familiar, but I do not realize it. Then in that case, you can just request me to go back and explain the whole thing. So is this introductory part clear to all of you? Just remember these few things. Just remember these few things, that integrate it with proper limits. Do not jump steps. Start from the basic equation, d mu equals to RT dln F. For most of the cases of phase equilibrium, since we are teaching phase equilibrium, just to facilitate you to understand interface mass transfer. So therefore, we will be evaluating the fugacities of each component in the different phases. Mostly in this class, I do not get time to discuss different types of equilibrium like gas liquid or solubility or vapor liquid, solid liquid. I do not get time for all these things. We predominantly discuss vapor liquid equilibrium because you will find that even when you are doing mass transfer, the maximum portion of the mass transfer course will comprise of distillation. Because distillation is one of the most important chemical engineering operations that are performed universally across all chemical industries, right? So therefore, with that, till this much, I know there is a lot of confusion. I understand that happens, but please practice. Any particular doubts that you are having, we are going to discuss them. Come back to me. It can be in a class, it can be outside the class, but we can discuss it, right? So therefore, just remove everything. So just to note down what we have said, it was for any particular component I in any particular phase, remember one thing, the chemical potential has to be same in both the phases. Now this alpha and beta, they can be liquid vapor phases, they can be two liquid phases, they can be a solid vapor, they can be a solid liquid case. So, and it can also be a gas liquid. What I mean by a gas liquid, the gas and liquid are not the same components. When I say liquid vapor, it means that liquid and vapor are of the same components, right? So alpha, beta can be anything, no matter whatever we are doing, more or less this equation we have to remember. And so therefore we need to evaluate these two. For everything, whenever you are getting confused, go back to the pure component situation. Start, because remember one thing, in this particular subject, there's a lot of part marking that is there. Okay. So this is equals to minus h by t square dt. This equation you are highly aware of, isn't it? This equation you know, yes or no?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, variation of mu as a function of p and t. So therefore, at constant p, generally we break up all processes into isobaric and isothermal processes. So therefore, this was the equation that I had got from where I had said that constant T and ideal gas, what is this equal to? What is this equal to? D mu equals to VdP for a constant T, any substance, anything. And when it is an ideal gas, then D mu becomes equal to?
Yes, RT by PdP.
RT by PdP. I don't think that thermodynamics is so difficult at the end. Just request all of you to participate. That will be better. Okay. So till this much, all of us know. After that, what did we do? Then we simply subtracted this particular equations and we wrote always what we do. We write the same equation for a real gas. In fact, I had done, anyhow, I'll do it once more. Okay, wait. I need not write this once more and waste so much of time. So therefore, this is equal to d mu 0. And after that, what we do, from here, the thing, we go from the ideal gas state to the real state. I am not defining the real state. It can be liquid, solid, it need not be a real gas. To the real state. Here again we go from zero to the actual pressure, whatever be that actual pressure, this, and this is equals to RT dln F by P. Again, we go from the ideal gas state where F by P equals to 1 to the real state where it is F by P. From where every day I write this equation, so that this is equals to RT ln F by P equals to 0 to P. Assuming that you are also writing it with me so that you get thoroughly conversant with this particular equation. And after that, next, what did I do? Because hardly we'll be dealing with pure components. So therefore, most of the time we'll be dealing with mixtures. So for next thing, what we do is for component I in mixture. This is what we have done, right? For component I in mixture, again, I start with the same thing. Just give me 1 minute. Well, for component I in mixture, we simply replace we simply replace this particular equation. How are we going to replace this particular equation for component I in mixture? Can you tell me? This becomes mu I bar. What happens to V? Can you tell me? When we are dealing for component I in a mixture, what happens to V? How do we define V? Can you tell me?
Partial molar volume.
How do I denote that?
V bar.
First thing is, whenever I have to specify the component I. Second thing is, I have to put a bar, right? So therefore, instead of, so if I repeat this, So therefore, this becomes d mu I equals to V I bar dp, which is equals to R T D L N F I bar, right? Again, for component I in the ideal gas state, here I have V I bar 0 dp. Can you tell me what is this V I bar 0 dp? What is this equal to? In the last class, we had defined what is this in the ideal gas state. Can you tell me? Anybody of you? Come on. Can you give me the definition of VI bar equal to? Basic definition. Basic definition.
Del V by del N at constant dp.
Who is responding? Is it Sneh or who is it? Who is this?
Ma'am,
Sneh. Other than Sneh, I would like to have responses from others, please. So therefore, this is T P N J not equal to L. Perfect. So therefore, then this becomes del N I of say N 1. V1 bar plus N2 V2 bar, etc. And then when we go for ideal gases, then in that case, this becomes del Ni of N1 RT by P plus N2 RT by P plus so on to Ni RT by P plus so on. Now, when I differentiate this, what do I get?
RT by P.
What do I get? Yes, please.
RT by P.
So all these terms go away, only this term stays. So this is again Sneh, I believe. Anybody, please. I would request all of you to respond, please. Okay. So therefore, instead of this, what do we have? I can write it down as RT by PDP. And in this case, this should be RTDLN. What do you have in the ideal gas state? This should be?
P.
P.
This should, louder, please.
Ma'am, I was having one
question.
Yes, please.
Ma'am, in the expression which we wrote, mu minus mu naught equal to RT ln F by P. In that, the pressure is the pressure of, it should be pressure of the reference state, right?
Hey, I'm not able to understand. Can you tell me, is it this equation?
Yes.
Please, just little slowly you tell me. What is it?
We have written RT ln F by P. So in that the pressure should be of the reference state, right?
Yes, perfect, completely correct. It is the not of the reference state. Sorry. See, yeah, this particular pressure. See, we are going from the ideal gas state to the real state. Remember one thing: ideal gas state. What is the ideal gas state? Normally, it is from P equals to zero, right? But in this particular case, what we are exactly doing is we are going from the ideal gas state to the real gas state. Therefore, if the dp has to vary from 0 to p, I agree. But in the ideal gas state, what is this is dln f by p. So in this term, in this particular equation, the limits have to be in terms of f by p. You agree with me?
Yes, ma'am. But the p which we have taken there.
One minute. We are always going from ideal gas state to real state, right? So if we have to do this here, then we have to go from 0 to P. Now, in the ideal gas state, can you tell me what is F by P equals to?
1.
So that's why we have put this to this. Okay, if I just, what I am exactly precisely doing is, I've got a real state, okay? And I've got a ideal state. I am basically moving from the ideal state to the real state. So therefore, what I am doing in the ideal state, the properties were mu zero. Yes, please. F equals one. Who is it, by the way?
Ajay.
Okay, fine. Acha. So therefore, yeah. So therefore, in the real state, what do you have? You have mu, you have got F. Is it clear to you? So therefore, we are actually moving from an ideal state to the real state. Okay. Now we know that for this particular equation, then it has to move from 1 to F by P. And in this particular equation, we know that the ideal gas state can only be at zero pressure. So if we have to know the property change of this particular property, when any gas any substance moves from the ideal to the real gas state, that we can know only if we integrate from 0 to P. Am I clear to you?
Yes, ma'am.
See, I cannot see you people. It's very bad. I do not see what happens in the class. I can even look at your body language. I can understand. Just by voices, it's very difficult and it's extremely sad for us also. So therefore, please respond. See, and I would expect that you are responding honestly. There's no other way by which I can communicate with you. Okay. So is this part clear to you? Basically, what we are doing
The pressure is of the real gas there, right?
Exactly. Pressure is of the real gas. But at that real gas pressure, if the gas would have been ideal, then what would have been its situation, right? If at the real gas pressure, if the gas would have been ideal, then its mu would have been mu zero. Then its F would have been P. Okay. But since it is not ideal, since it is real, therefore, instead of P, its fugacity is F. And you would like to find out F with respect to P. How can you do it? You have to find the integration of this particular term for this. Now, for this particular term, you have to go from the ideal gas state to the real gas state at the state P. Now, this you cannot do because moment you are dealing with PV behavior, you have to remember that the ideal gas state, it was possible at P equals to zero. So even at P equals to P, if you have to move from an ideal gas state at P to a real gas state at P, and you have to know the change in any this particular property, then in that case, the integration has to be performed from a state where the gas is actually ideal to the state where the substance is existing. So just for getting a realistic value of this integral, we have to do it from here to here. You can find out that for a lot of cases, people assume 1 bar or a very low pressure and they integrate it to this pressure. Okay. Lot of times when zero pressure gives something unrealistic, then they start from a very low finite value. Is it clear to all of you? Remember one thing, I'm trying to go from an ideal gas state to the real gas state under the same conditions of temperature and pressure. Just the way I had defined the residual properties, if you remember, there it was a real gas, here it is a real substance. And from here, I had wanted to go to an ideal gas state, and the property change which happens, that particular property change, I had defined it for molar property in this particular way, and which gives you M minus M0, this gives you capital M minus M0, right? So in this particular way, in this particular case also, I am trying to go from a real substance. It is not a gas, but it is from a real substance to an ideal gas state. Now, and I want to find out in the real substance, I know the properties mu, the fugacity is F and the pressure is P. For the ideal gas state, it is mu zero and F zero equals to P. right? So therefore, for finding out F, I know F0 equals to P. So therefore, from here to here, the property change. What I do, I know the property changes from F to P. So therefore, when I can integrate it as F by P, okay? And I can find this out. But when I have to integrate this V, this here the property was V. In this particular case, it was RT by P. Let me. Okay, so from V property, I have to go to RT by P. Now, how both of them definitely are at the same pressures. I agree. But the problem is that actual and ideal gas at this pressure does not exist. This was a fictitious state. So therefore, if I have to find this particular change, then I know that RT by P will be equal to RT by RT ln F, but that will happen only at P equals to 0. Therefore, I take that for finding out the change of this particular term, we have to go from this lower limit to this upper limit. This lower limit corresponds to nothing but the ideal gas state. Now, is it clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
So remember one thing, we are going from the ideal gas state to real gas state, both of which are at the same pressure. But the ideal gas state at pressure P, that is a fictitious situation, right? So, but we know that had the gas been ideal at the pressure P, then its fugacity would have been defined as RT ln P. Now, since it is real, so it is defined by RT ln F. And we want to find out the difference between the fugacity and the pressure of the real gas at pressure P. Now, for that, we would have to evaluate this particular integral from the ideal gas state to the real gas state. Now, since at P, this is a fictitious state, so therefore, in order to find this out, we can further say that this particular ideal gas state, this is equal to the ideal gas state at P equals to 0. And therefore, we put the integration from 0 to P. Is this part clear?
Yes, ma'am.
So therefore, now...
Ma'am, I have a doubt.
Yes, please.
Suppose in evaluating that integral, V minus RT by P dP, at lower limit, at P equal to 0. Suppose it is not possible to evaluate at P equal to 0, then what we will do?
See, the point is, when you come across that, normally what do we do? In that particular case, we either take a limit P tends to 0. You will find that a lot of time, we start from P equals to 1 bar and we go. Okay, we just write it in this particular way, but several times we start from P equals to 1 bar. It has to be a very low pressure, that is it.
Okay, so we can assume that at P equal to 1 bar, the gas is ideal.
Yeah, behaving at very, very low pressure, the gas is ideal. That we can assume. Okay, that depends on the problem. See, under some particular conditions, the PV behavior is such that this integration is possible. If at any point this integration is not possible, say from P equals to 0, then we assume P equals to 1 bar and we can perform this integration. If you come across this specific problem, you can contact me later and I can clarify it further. Just remember, this has to be from the ideal gas state. Figuratively, we write it as 0. For any particular specific problem, it can be taken any particular low pressure. Definitely, at the lowest that you can take, we assume that to be 1 bar.
Ma'am?
Yes, please.
Ma'am, you have said that we take from ideal gas to somewhere. So, is it only possible for real gases or we can also do it for liquids?
My dear, we can do it for solids also. This is the first thing that I've been repeatedly telling. Remember? But this one thing, our main purpose of replacing this particular term, where did it go? Hi, Gopal. Wait. No, this is here. My main purpose of replacing this with, let me write it down. Wait. my main purpose of writing this particular equation is that this equation is applicable for every substance on earth. It is applicable for liquids, solids, gases, and possibly we have also discussed how to find out the fugacity of a pure liquid. Do you remember? This equation is applicable for everything. For every single particular substance, we simply evaluate it in terms of the real gas, just because we know it. If it would have been a liquid also, the same equation would have been applicable. But in that case, what we do, we simply integrate this particular term from zero pressure, where that substance was a gas. The substance remains a gas from zero pressure to what pressure, can you tell me? Any particular substance remains a gas till which pressure?
Saturation.
So therefore, suppose we would have started with a condensed phase, then in that case, what we would have done, we would have performed this integration to from zero to P saturated, and then we would have added another term from P saturated to P, V condensed minus RT by P dP. Right? But if you add it, it's the same. We go from zero to P. But we have to be sure that we know the value at each and every integral. Now we know that at P saturated, there is a discontinuity which occurs when we are going from the gas to the liquid state. So for that particular condition, what we do, that when we do it for a liquid phase, then we break the integral, we perform the first integration for the gas or the vapor which is in equilibrium with the liquid, assuming that the vapor behaves as an ideal gas. So when it is a liquid and not a gas, this particular integral is integrated in the same way. We integrate it for the corresponding vapor of the substance from zero to P saturated, the entire range where the vapor exists. And then at P saturated, what happens? The liquid and it converts to the liquid, and the liquid and the vapor, both of them, they have got the same mu, right? So therefore, conversion of vapor to liquid at P saturated, that does not involve any change of mu or any change of F. So that particular integration we did not perform. Otherwise, we needed to have something from P saturated liquid to P saturated vapor. Normally, what we should have, P saturated vapor. There should be something as P saturated liquid plus P saturated vapor into this whole thing dP. Now this part is zero. So what we do, we go from zero to P saturated vapor, and then this part from P saturated vapor to P saturated liquid, integrating this thing is zero. So again, we go from P saturated liquid or vapor, whatever, to the actual P of the condensed phase, and we integrate this thing. If we had a solid, then this integration would have gone till the solidification temperature of the solid. Again, at the solidification point, we know that the liquid and the solid would have been in equilibrium. And again, after that, we would have added another from the solidification temperature to pressure to the pressure. And this particular term, again, it would have to be integrated for the solid. Am I clear to you?
Yes, ma'am. So I was saying that there was a question in assignment, question 6, where we had been given a liquid and it was in condensed phase, and we had to find its property using steam table.
Perfect.
So perfect. We would take from ideal gas situation to saturation, and then from perfect saturation
but
to
saturated conditions, you have to identify from the steam table.
Yes, ma'am. So for steam table, we'll take it from ideal gas to its saturated condition, right?
Perfect. Perfect. That saturated conditions you have to identify. Not only that, for the next part of integration, you need to know V, isn't it? So that V at the saturated conditions, that also you need to identify. And if you find that the V is changing a lot from the saturated pressure to the pressure which has been set, then that V has to be within the integration, or else you can take it out of the integration. Then in that case, your life becomes much more simpler. Now you can take it out only if your P saturated and the P is closed. I think that, I don't remember, there were a very high pressure also possibly. If the pressure is very high, then this particular VC, more or less, it has to be done in this particular way. It has to be VC into P minus 1. Normally, we can assume the condensed phase to be incompressible. Just check up the molar volume from the steam tables. Yes, next question. See, whenever you are asking questions, I feel happy because that shows that you are studying. Maybe you are not liking and studying, but at least you are studying. Any other questions or do I proceed? Okay, then. So you tell me that this was for the mixture, component I in mixture. Now for component I in ideal gas mixture, component I in ideal gas mixture. This term is fine for all of you? Come on, at least say yes or no.
Yes, ma'am.
This term is fine for you? This I have already derived and shown?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes,
ma'am. Here, what do I write?
P.
Total pressure. This is for component I in an ideal gas mixture. So for component I, the total pressure is P. But what is the pressure of component? See, here everything I'll be integrating for component I, right? So for the ideal gas state, for component I, the total pressure of the mixture was P. What is the pressure of component I in that ideal mixture? Can you tell me?
Why I
put it as PI. I know it's YIP. Perfect. Now for the time being, let us put it for PI. So again, I subtracted. Why I'm trying to show you this is, so from here, what do I get? D mu, and remember the difference between a cap and a bar. Okay, that is also something very important. Which this is equal to again integral 0 to P. This is again from ideal. I am writing it because there will be cases where we will go from pure state to mixture state. But this is from ideal gas state to real mixture state. And real mixture can be a solid mixture, liquid mixture, gaseous mixture. I don't bother. Okay. Real mixture state. This will be Vi bar minus RT by P dP. And this is going to be equal to RT d ln Fi bar by Pi. What will be the limits of integration? For the ideal gas state, what is it going to be? The limits of integration, remember, this is the same for everything. So here the limits of integration is going to be, come on.
Zero.
One.
Perfect. And here it is going to be Fi bar by Pi. So therefore, for this particular case, then in this particular case, I can write it down as RT ln Fi bar by Pi. This is equal to integral 0 to P Vi bar minus RT. This is just a revision. This has already been done in the previous class, right? And this particular term, this ratio is known as Fi bar by Pi.
Pi.
Yes, please.
Pi.
It's Phi I a cap on the top, right? So therefore, this I have written for component I in a real mixture, right? This whole thing I have derived for component I in mixture, right? Now, we have one particular mixture which is exists in both the liquid phase and the vapor phase, right? There's a mixture here and there's a mixture here. For the vapor mixture, I can write this down. And again, for the liquid mixture, I can write this down. Then for the vapor mixture, I have to find out this. For each component, I have to find this out. Liquid mixture, for each component, I have to find this out. If it is a binary mixture, then I've got just two things. I will be having one F1 V bar, F2 V bar. See, the only thing is, do not be in a hurry. Okay, if you're not in a hurry, you put everything properly, it will never be difficult. Here we have F1 bar liquid, sorry, F2 bar liquid. So therefore, what we have to do in order, if we have to find out whether any component will transfer from here to here, we need to calculate this, find out the difference between the two. That will give us whether at all mass transfer will occur and in which direction mass transfer will occur. Will component one move from the vapor to the liquid phase or vice versa? In the same way, we have to find out these two and again compare to find out if there is at all any mass transfer. We always want mass transfer for separation and enrichment, right? Either we want to mix two things or we want to separate the things. These are the things which we would always like to do for any sort of enrichment or for making any particular products. Whatever we are doing considering that there is no chemical reaction, there is just interface mass transfer. Chemical reaction would add more to the complexity of the situation, right? We are not considering that at the moment, fine. So therefore, we need to find this out. Now for finding this out, what do we need? We need data on VI bar. At what condition do we need VI bar? Can you tell me? To find out this at any particular condition, say we want to find this out, this particular mixture is at T and P. So therefore we need this, say Fi, say V, we need this at, say, a temperature and pressure. We need this at some temperature and pressure. So for finding this out, what is it that we need? What are the data that you need to find this and to find this? Can you tell me?
VI bar.
You need VI bar. Can you tell me under what condition you need VI bar?
The same condition as at temperature T. We need to.
Sure. So therefore, you mean to say that you need VI bar at PT. Is this 40? What you had meant?
Yes, ma'am.
Perfect. Anybody who thinks that he's not correct?
Ma'am, if equation of state is not given, then we need VI bar at various points so that we can numerically integrate.
Even if equation of state is given, remember that in order to find this out, you have to perform this integration. So even if equation of state is given, then also and assuming that the equation of state is applicable over the entire range from 0 to P, then you can substitute the equation of state and then you can do it. Now my next question. Equations of states are given for what? For gases? Yes or no?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
For pure gases? Yes or no?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. And we have discussed some mixing and combining rules to obtain the total property of the gases. Remember, if you remember, we had discussed these properties so that we can find out Vm, Hm, etc., etc. Using those equations of states, we could just find out the total mixture properties. We did not discuss finding out Vi bar, Hi bar, blah, 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 blah. Did we? Just recall why we did not do? Because VI bar, it is definitely a function of pressure temperature. But VI bar is also a function of something else. Can you tell me? VI bar, it is a function of? Anybody?
Composition.
Perfect. Very good. Whoever it is, that is just, it's not for nothing, but just if their grades can be enhanced due to their responses, I would request the TAs to just note down. It is not for putting any pressure or something. So anyhow, so this also depends on Xi. Assuming that it is a liquid, or else if it is a vapor, then it is a YI. More correctly, this depends on composition. So therefore, try to understand that if you have to find out Fi bar, then in order to find out whether mass transfer goes on, does not go on, it can go on under certain compositions, does not go on under certain compositions. So therefore, you have to find out Vi bar for every composition. You need to find out Vi bar as a function of composition at fixed PT. And then you have to find out Vi as a function of composition right from P equals to 0 to P equals to P at every single P. Is this part clear to all of you?
Yes, ma'am.
So therefore, have you realized that till now we have the only way by which we can find out Vi bar is by the method of intercepts. What does the method of intercepts give you? It gives you Vi bar in terms of the volume, the molar volume of the mixture, etc. for different compositions at a fixed P and T. So from there, we can find out Vi bar as a function of composition at fixed P and T. Now, we need to know how that Vi bar at each composition varies from 0 to P. So therefore, the same graph has to be drawn, and by the method of intercepts, you have to find out Vi bar from 0 to P for every single case. Now, this is a Herculean task. Already you are tired with thermodynamics, so therefore this gives you an added pain, isn't it? Now, whenever we are faced with something very, very complex anywhere in engineering, it's not chemical, it's not thermodynamics, anywhere in engineering, whenever we find that we are not able to find out the data or the physics is too complex for us to understand, we leave the onus of understanding the basics, the science of behind that particular phenomena to the scientists. We try to bring up some particular idealizations based on which we can define some simplified equations from which we can calculate the properties. And more or less, we find conditions under which those idealizations are applicable. We use the idealizations for those conditions, and for conditions where the idealizations are not applicable, for those particular conditions, what we do, we try to introduce some particular correction factors, right? We know ideal gas state, what is it? PV equals to RT. Now we have to go for the real gas state. What did we do? We modified this equation. How did we modify this equation? Tell me.
By pressure correction and volume correction.
That you can do, or else basically we had introduced a compressibility factor. Okay. And then this compressibility factor, it can be obtained from different ways. Cubic equation is also one way. Okay. So you can either represent it in that way, or same thing we had represented as an equation of state. Fine. Again, the same thing, such type of correction factors everywhere we try to introduce. And for example, you try to find out the property changes of real gases, real gas mixtures, maybe enthalpy, entropy, whatever it is. What we did, we found out the corresponding properties in the ideal gas state. And then what we introduced delta H star. Now we want to find out, say, mu I in any particular state alpha, say. So what we did, we replaced this with phi I alpha. Why did we do it? Because we know phi I zero alpha, or rather phi I zero at the gas state, which is equals to pi. So therefore, what we did, now we would like to find out the difference. So every time, whenever we are stuck up, we resort to ideal gases, we try to find out how they behave. Accordingly, we try to emulate and set up some equations which will be more or less similar to that. We find out conditions where those will be applicable, say low pressure, blah, blah, etc. And when they are not applicable, then we introduce some particular correction factors, right? So even for mixtures also, we had planned to do the same thing. Even for mixtures also, if you find, we find that finding out Fi bar from this equation, it's very difficult. So we need to do something else. What is that something else that we can do? Again, we refer to gaseous mixtures. For component I in the mixture, again I repeat, for component I, component I in the mixture, say suppose it is a gaseous mixture I take, I can simply write it down as, I have already derived it, therefore I am writing it directly here, 0 to P Vi bar minus RT by P dP, right? And for pure component I, that same I when it is not in mixture, it is a pure component, we can write it down as Fi P by P equals to integral 0 to P Vi minus RT by P dP. Now, for ideal mixtures, or rather mixture of ideal gases, can you tell me a law which is obeyed by mixture of ideal gases?
Amagat's law. Amagat's law,
definitely. So therefore, from Amagat's law, what do we know? We know V mixture equals to sigma Ni Vi, right? Which implies that Vi equals to Vi bar, isn't it? So therefore, from Amagat's law, we know that the mixtures, they mix without any change in volume. That is what we knew, right? So suppose for component I, and remember one thing, Amagat's law, it is not only applicable for mixture of ideal gases, this is also applicable for ideal mixture of real gases. So therefore, it is less restrictive than ideal gas law. Because what do we say? We say that the volumes they mix, there is no change in the total volume, which means that suppose there are two molecules A and B, and when they mix, then the interactions between AA, BB and AB molecules, they are the same. Do you get my point?
Yes,
for ideal gases, what did we say? They do not interact at all. But for real, for this particular case, then ideal mixture of real gases, what do we say? They definitely interact. But the interactions are similar in the pure state and the mixture state. So therefore, this is less restrictive as compared to a mixture of ideal gases. And this is Amagat's law. It is actually applicable for a ideal mixture of real gases. This is applicable for any particular mixture of real gases, right? So therefore, we can always assume that for an gaseous mixture, Vi bar is equal to Vi, or in other words, the right-hand side, it cancels out. And therefore, in this particular case, what we can write? We can write that RT ln Fi bar by YiP equals to RT ln Fi by P. From this, what do I get? What do I get from this? Can you tell me? Come on.
Fi cap equals to yi fi.
Can you tell me what is this Fi equals to? Anybody? What is this Fi equals to? Fugacity of what?
Fugacity of pure component I.
Perfect. Fugacity of component, little more participation please. Fugacity of pure component I. under fourth condition, remember one thing, I could cancel this this out only when this 0 to p are the same. And I am performing this whole thing at the same pressure so that RT by P is the same both. So therefore, remember one thing for this particular cancellation, fugacity of component I, rather pure component I at T and P of mixture, which means that Fi bar at TP, or in other words, Fi and Fi bar at same T and P. This is one thing you have to remember, that this particular law, this is applicable only when the pure component and the mixture, both of them are at the same temperature and pressure. Fine for all of you? So therefore, if I write it down, fine. So therefore, if I write it down for the vapor phase, what do? I write a vapor here and I write a vapor here. Agreed, all of you? And
yes,
perfect. Now, if I would have done it for a liquid phase, then in that case, what would I have done? In that case, again, remember this integration would have been 0 to P saturated and P saturated to P. Never mind whatever it is, you have to remember that this equation and this equation had to be from the same 0 to P saturated to P. Here again, 0 to P saturated to P. And then this and this would have been equal. And under that condition also, I can write this down. But in a liquid phase, what I do, I denote the mole fraction as X. This is something that you need to remember. Consistently, mole fraction in liquid phase is X. Consistently, mole fraction in vapor phase will be denoted by Y. So therefore, for the liquid phase, in the same way, if we proceed, we would have got RT ln Fi by XiP is equals to RT ln Fi liquid, this is liquid, by P. Right. One thing let me specify, for pure component fugacity, if you go through textbooks, someone puts a star, zero, etc., etc., I'll not do anything. For my particular class, a superscript zero refers to the ideal gas, and any particular alphabet without any sort of superscript or anything, that denotes the pure component. The superscript denotes the state of the pure component. This is one thing that you need to remember. So from here, for a liquid also, what do I get? Same way, FIL bar equals to XIFIL. Any doubts, anybody, till this much? Am I clear to all of you?
Yes, ma'am.
If that is so, and what other thing that I know, that at equilibrium, this has to be equal to this, right? Now, when what you are supposed to do then, you know how to calculate FIV. Lot of techniques are there. You know how to calculate FIL. Already discussed, pure component fugacities. So therefore, what you need to do, you need to, if you know the composition of the mixture, very simply you can find this out. You need know the composition in the liquid state, very conveniently you can find this term. Compare this, and then decide whether there is going to be any mass transfer of component I from the liquid to the vapor phase or vice versa. At equilibrium, what will you get? Which signifies no mass
FL, cap L is equals to FLB.
Perfect. At equilibrium, FIL cap equals to FIB cap. Or in other words, what does this give you? This is again the, I'm simply repeating the previous class till now, 1 hour went away. So therefore, this is nothing but FIFIB equals to XIFIL. Fine for you? And what is this known as, can you tell me? These
Raoult's law.
Hey, this is not Raoult's law. Wait, we have not come to, this is ideal solution model. this particular thing was first suggested by two scientists, Lewis and Randall. So this is Lewis Randall model, or this is known as ideal solution model in terms of fugacity. Now I have got another simplification. See, we had simplified this whole thing by assuming this part, okay, and provided FIV, FIL and all these caps, everything as at the same temperature and pressure, we can write this down. Now, mostly we deal with low pressure conditions. At least when you are in your second year thermodynamics, we can make some concessions and we can say that for most of the cases, we will be dealing with low to moderate pressures, where we can assume that the gas can behave ideally. If we can do that, then if the gas is behaving or the vapor is behaving ideally, what is FIV equals?
P, pressure.
Not gas, it should be the vapor force. Perfect. This is the pressure of the system. Total pressure. Okay, you can put it PT or T4. Can you tell me what is the fugacity of the pure component liquid when the vapor in equilibrium is behaving as an ideal vapor and the PT is not very far, it is almost equal to the saturated pressure. Under that condition, what is FIL equals to, can you tell me? If you remember.
Pure component saturation.
Louder, please.
Pure component saturation.
If you remember, we had a PI saturated, then there was a phi IV, then there was a pointing correction factor, 0 to P, B condensed. Do you remember this thing? DP and etc. So for an ideal gas, this goes off. When this is close to this, this goes off. And FIL is equals to PI saturated. So now for low to moderate pressure, this ideal solution model, how can it be written down? Ideal solution model, this becomes then for, tell me, YI into, come on.
P total.
P total or PT, whatever it is, XI into?
P saturation.
PI saturated for that component. I same voice again. And therefore, the ideal solution model reduces to Raoult's law for low to moderate pressures under conditions when the vapor in equilibrium with the liquid solution behaves ideally and the pressure is not very far removed from the saturated vapor pressure. So now the next question comes that what are the other properties of ideal solutions? Point one. And which solutions conform to the ideal solution model? So do I give a break, but not a very big break, maybe 5 minutes break. Do you want it or do you want me to continue?
Yes,
and
yes.
Yes, definitely. It is 12:17 in my watch. Okay, I'll start exactly at 12:22 because today I had talked a lot and therefore had wasted a lot of time. Within this time, take a break and just think that what can be the other properties of ideal solutions and what type of liquid solutions for gases, all gas mixtures, they obey ideal solution model. For liquids, what type of solutions do you expect are going to obey the ideal solution model? So we stop for 5 minutes and we start exactly at 12:22 of my watch. It is 12:17 in my watch now. Okay, bye. Pranita, are you there? Pranita, are you there by any chance? Pallavi, is Pranita there?
Hello, ma'am. Pranita is there, ma'am, but I don't know why she is not responding.
So then just what I wanted, that she has not sent the email to me regarding the absentees.
I informed her, ma'am. She will send you within 10 to 15 minutes, ma'am.
No problem. But to let her take it and just, okay, after the class, I'll talk with her for 2 minutes. Okay?
Yes. Okay. Yes.
can we start now?
Yes, ma'am.
Good, very good. Sneha is there. Shomik? Soham?
Yes, ma'am.
Very good. Nidhi?
Yes, ma'am.
Nidhi? Nidhi yes. Cannot be. Yes, ma'am. Rakesh?
Yes, ma'am.
Very good. Varun?
Yes, ma'am.
Good, 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 good. Let us start. Acha, wait. Let me, I forgot to share. Just a minute. Yeah. So, therefore, first let us start with the properties. Okay. And then we will find out that, can you often guess which solutions do you, liquid solutions, do you expect would obey the your ideal solution model? Any guesses? On what basis was the ideal solution model developed? Can you tell me?
The interaction between two different components.
So therefore, ideal solution model will be obeyed when the interactions between the like and the unlike molecules will be similar. Can you suggest any particular classes of compounds, or maybe any specific examples where you think that ideal solution model can be obeyed? Any particular example?
Benzene and toluene.
What about ethanol, methanol?
Yes, ma'am.
There also it is going to happen. So therefore, there are certain things which you need to remember. In liquid solutions, when components, molecules are similar in size and chemical nature, right? It can be isomers. This part you need to remember. It can be isomers. It can be adjacent members of homologous series, just the way you are telling benzene, toluene, etc. It can be orthoxylene, metaxylene, etc., etc. It also can be isotopes, right? So for these particular things, they obey. Then the next thing is definitely for gaseous mixtures. I've already told you that they are similar. And one more thing you remember, that for low pressure, definitely when the gases behave ideally, under that condition, definitely it happens. And also you remember that for any particular condition, if that component is in large excess. Okay, so therefore, if you are plotting the vapor mole fraction with the liquid mole fraction, you find that when the component is in large excess, then naturally the like unlike molecules are very less in number. So therefore, under that particular conditions, definitely all particular components, when they are in large excess in any particular solution, definitely they are going to conform to the ideal solution model. All gases, the gaseous mixture, conform to the ideal solution model. And for liquids, isomers, homologous series, all these things, they also conform to the ideal solution model. Now let us see what are the properties of ideal solutions. First property which I have already mentioned to you, definitely this first property is Vi equals to Vi bar. What does it mean? It means that the total volume of the solution is supposedly Ni Vi bar. Yes or no? Yes or no? The total volume of the solution, whatever be the solution, right? Come on. Anybody? And molar volume of the solution is, can you tell me? Come on, anybody, any responses?
Summation xi.
Mole fraction into Vi bar.
Perfect. This is going to be xi Vi bar. Now, before mixing, what was the total volume of individually before mixing? V before mixing, if we take, this will be equal to NiVi. Yes or no? And V molar volume in that case, if you take before mixing, this is equals to NiVi. Sorry, very sorry. This is going to be XiVi. Agreed? So therefore, what is V mix? V mix should be V solution minus V before mixing. Do you agree with me?
Yes, ma'am.
So therefore, what is this equals to sigma Ni Vi bar minus sigma Ni Vi, or in other words, sigma Ni Vi bar minus Vi. Now, for ideal solutions, what have we got? Vi bar equals to Vi, which means the volume change on mixing, or the V mixing, that is equals to zero, and the molar volume change of mixing is also equal to zero. Do you agree with me?
Yes, ma'am. Sorry.
Yeah, so this has to be delta V, very sorry. Delta V mix. Fine. So the first property is that the ideal solutions, they mix without any change of volume. Let us see what other properties are there. Suppose we take the next property. See, for everything, again, I start from the very basics. Fi equals to, say, Yi Fi. Okay, it's V or L, whatever it is. From here, can I write down del ln Fi? Even if you are recording the lectures, it will be good if you can copy these things. If you find that I should go a bit slow, you can always tell that to me. Right. Now, can you, what is del ln Fi del T, and what is del ln Fi? Fi cap del T and del ln Fi del T, let us see. Again, if you don't remember any equations, no harm. We can start. This also has been covered, but just as a revision, we can start from the very beginning. If you have forgotten everything, this equation definitely you had learned, you will not forget. So from this equation, what do I get? I get this. What is G? It is nothing but mu by T equals to H by T minus T. So therefore, from here, what do I get? Del mu by T del T at cost. Lot of derivations I am doing just as a revision. This particular part. So from here, what do I get? This is equal to del del T of H by T at constant P minus del S del T at constant P. From here, what do I get? I get 1 by T del H del T at constant P minus H by T square minus del S del T at constant P. What is this equal to? Can you tell me? Del H del T at constant P, that is equal to? What is this part, del H del T at constant P? Anybody? Louder? It was correct. Louder, please. Del H del T at constant P, what is this equal to? Anybody?
Cp.
Cp. So therefore, this becomes Cp by T. You have already done in your before mid-sem class, this is also equal to Cp by T, right? So therefore, this becomes equal to minus H by T square. Agree? Now, how to relate it with fugacity? Again, let us start from the basics. There is a differential equation which relates this, right? Let us start if it is a pure component, we can start from mu zero to mu, completely from the basics, f equals to p to f. So from here, what do we get? We get mu minus mu zero equals to RT ln f by p. Any part you do not understand, simply stop me and tell it. Now, we are dealing with different components. So even in the pure state, we would like to identify the components. This is mu I, this is fi. Completely pure state, I am doing it, right? So therefore, this is equal to RT ln fi minus RT ln p. Fine? Now, suppose I divide the whole thing with t, I get mu I by t minus mu I 0 by t equals to R ln fi minus R ln p, right? Now, suppose just in order to get this particular equation, because from this particular equation, I can get this, I would like to arrive at this equation. I know this, I want to find out this, I want to find out this, right? So therefore, in order to apply this equation, what do I do? Del of this, del t at constant p, del del t of this constant p, del del t constant p, del del t constant p. Yes or no? Any problems if I do this? Come on. Is this part fine for all of you? Rohit? Rishabh?
Hello.
I just want to know whether this part is fine for you, if you have not understood any part of what I have done. Shivans? Shivans Raj? Shashank Gautam? Come on, is this part fine for all of you? So, this disappears off, isn't it? So, what is this del del t of mu I by t? Anybody who can tell me? Looking at this particular equation,
that's perfect.
This is equal to minus 8i by t, pure component, mind it. What is this? Plus hi 0 by, sorry, t square, very sorry, t square, right? And what is this equals to? This is equals to r del ln fi del t at constant p. Fine? So therefore, from here, for a pure component, I know that this is nothing but this, or in other words, I can write it down as del ln fi del t at p equals to minus hi by h minus of hi minus hi 0 rt square. Agreed? This was for a pure component. Let us do this same thing for the mixture. In the mixture, what do I have? D mu I cap. Again, I start from mu I 0 to mu I cap. Same limits I have written, because I want to compare this with the del ln fi cap. If you see, I want to compare this and I want to compare this. So they have to be at the same initial state. So therefore, whatever state I've kept here for the same state. I should have put a mu to mu I here also. This also should have been an fi. This also should have been an fi. Fine. So therefore, in this particular case, this is equal to rt integral fi bar to fi bar. This fi bar equals to pi. D ln fi bar. So from here, what do I get? I get mu I bar minus mu I 0. This is equals to RT ln fi bar by pi. Agree? So therefore, from this, what do I get? Again, from here, I get mu I by T. See, I'm not jumping any step so that you don't face any difficulty. R ln Fi by Pi. Next, what I do? Del del T of this, which is nothing but R del del T of ln Fi minus del del T of ln Pi. Everything is at constant pressure. Definitely the partial pressure at constant total pressure, the partial pressure is not a function of I. So therefore, from this case, what do I get? I know del del T of mu I bar, what is it? Can you tell me? This is equal to, I have already derived this particular equation from which I know del mu by T, del T is minus H by T square. So therefore, what is this equation? Del del T of mu I bar by T at constant P. Can you tell me this is equal to? Come on, this is equal to?
H bar by T.
H I bar by T square minus this is equals to H I zero by T square. This is equals to, let me put a R here. This becomes del ln Fi del T at constant P. Fine. So therefore, now if I compare del ln Fi del T and del ln Fi bar del T, what do I get? Yes, please.
Ma'am, shouldn't there be a minus, shouldn't there be a plus sign in the last line which you wrote?
That can happen. Plus, minus, I am very bad, you know. Where should, oh yeah. Here, though. Yeah, I am very bad in plus, minus. Okay. So therefore, where did we start? We started with the basic thing as from here. So this equals this. So if this equals to this, then from these two equations, what do I get? This term is equal to this term, which implies that if this term has to be equal to this term, then in that case, minus hi minus hi 0 by rt square should be equal to minus hi bar minus hi 0 by rt square, which automatically implies hi equals to hi bar. Agreed? So therefore, from here again I know that H of the solution that is equal to sigma ni hi bar, H before mixing was equals to sigma ni hi. So therefore, the property change delta H mixing that equals to sigma ni hi bar minus hi. If hi bar equals, if this equals this, then in that case, from that, what do I get? The enthalpy change for mixing is equal to, come on, if this equals to this, then the enthalpy change of mixing equals
zero.
So molar enthalpy change of mixing equals to zero. So property 3 tells you that when ideal solutions form, there is neither evolution nor absorption of heat. So therefore, the volume does not change. There is no volume change of mixing. There is no enthalpy change of mixing. Now, if these two are applicable, Then in that case, what is the third property? Let us see. Are you aware of this, the basic equation defining enthalpy? You are aware of this equation, yes or no?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Perfect. Perfect. So therefore, for any component, I can write this down, yes or no?
Yes, ma'am.
For component I in solution, I can write this fine. I have already shown that HI equals to HI bar. I have already shown VI equals to VI bar. From these two and these two, what does it mean? UI equals to UI bar. Or in other words, when an ideal solution is formed, there is no internal energy change of mixing as well. So therefore, from here I know delta Vm equals to zero for ideal solutions. Delta Hm equals to zero. Delta Um equals to zero. Can you tell me how to find out delta Gm, and just to find out if delta G mixing is also equal to zero or something else? Let us again start from the basics, right? G solution, if I write down, this is equals to Na mu A bar plus Nb mu B bar. Please note that whenever I write something with capital, it automatically means it's a total property. I could have also written G solution equals to XA mu A bar plus XB mu B bar. For the time being, these are all for binary solutions. For whatever we do for binary solutions, we can simply extend it to other solutions as well. G before mixing, for did we have Na mu A pure component plus Nb mu B. So therefore, in this particular case, what is the delta G mixing? This will be Na mu A cap minus mu A plus Nb mu B cap minus mu B. Similarly, delta G mixing will be XA mu A cap minus mu A plus XB mu B cap minus mu B. So therefore, for N components, we can write down delta G mixing equals to sigma xi mu I bar minus mu I. Can I write this down? Yes or no? Yes or no? Can I write whatever I have done for this? This part is fine for all of you.
Yes.
Now, can you tell me how are these two related? Again, to find out how these two are related, we'll start from the basics. If you find out, I'm always dealing with simply two or three basic equations. To find out this difference, again, let us go with the basic equation. This is equal to RT DLN FI. You agree with me? Sorry. Mu I. This you agree with me?
Yes, ma'am.
For the pure component, this is RT DLN FI. Now suppose I subtract the two. See, in this particular case, my integration actually I am doing from pure component to that in mixture. So this I'll get mu I bar minus mu I. This is equals to RT DLN FI by bar by FI, right? this I start from pure component. Pure component means mu I bar equals to mu I, or this minus this equals to 0 to mu I bar minus mu I. Naturally, here also I start from the pure component situation, which is Fi bar minus Fi equals to 0 to Fi bar minus Fi. So therefore, when I perform this integration, what do I get? I get mu I bar minus mu I, this is equals to RT ln Fi bar by Fi. For an ideal solution, this becomes equal to, for an ideal, this was just for a general case. For an ideal solution, what is Fi bar equals to? That is true in terms of fugacity. See, we'll always use something which serves our purpose. So here we are going to use this thing, right? Because in this case, every fair, please remember, we are not bothered with the ideal gas state. We are bothered from the pure state to the solution state. So therefore, we find that mu I bar minus mu I is nothing but equal to ln went away, RT ln XI. This is something which you need to remember. So if this is the case, then instead of this, I can simply substitute it, and for do I get sigma XI, RT can go out, sigma XI ln XI. So therefore, delta, just like all of these was zero, delta G mixing is not equal to zero. It gives you RT sigma XI ln XI for an ideal solution. Now there's something that you should observe. XI is always less than one. Yes or no?
Yes, ma'am.
So ln XI is always positive or negative?
Negative.
So there's delta GM will all, R and T, they are all positive, right? So delta GM will always be
negative.
Which means that when solutions are formed, they form because it is accompanied by a decrease in the molar Gibbs free energy. Same thing when you have done such a lot, try to forget the first property which was there, the entropy of mixing. Delta S mixing, again see, we'll start from the very basic equation G equals to, see, every time I'm starting from a basic equation. From where I know S equals to H minus G by T. So therefore, delta S mixing, I can always put it as minus delta G mixing minus plus delta H mixing by T. I can do it, yes or no? What is delta H mix equals to, tell you, tell me, for an ideal solution?
Zero.
What is minus delta G mix for an ideal solution? Just now I have derived this. Where did I derive this? Yeah, just now I have derived this. This is equals to RT. So therefore, this becomes minus delta G mix by T. For the, does it become? It becomes minus R sigma XI ln XI. So therefore, just to complete this particular series, I put delta S mix or delta SM equals to minus R sigma XI ln XI. So therefore, from here you find that for any particular solution, a binary solution, it always forms, for the time being, we are talking about ideal solution. We'll find out that for non-ideal solution also the same thing happens. Delta G mix is always less than zero. Delta S mix is always greater than zero. Agreed?
Yes, ma'am.
So with this, we have come, these are the properties that we have discussed. Delta V mix equals to zero, H mix equals to zero. That means when an ideal solution forms, there is no volume change. There is no volume change, no enthalpy change, no internal energy change, and a spontaneous change in this, and a spontaneous change in this. Agreed? These are the properties of ideal solutions. So after this, what we do? We have discussed what are the properties. We have found out that under four conditions, any particular solution behaves as an ideal solution. So provided any particular solution behaves as an ideal solution, what should be the next thing that we should be doing? That for an ideal solution, suppose, then we'll discuss what happens when solutions are not ideal. For an ideal solution, suppose we take up any particular mixture, okay? Two phases, liquid phase, vapor phase, right? And this also forms an ideal solution. Vapor phase, under all conditions, this forms an ideal solution, right? So for such a thing, definitely we would like to find out all the properties and when these two ideal solutions are in equilibrium, right? Once we can find out all the properties, we can find out this Fi cap for every component, we can find out this for every component, then we can talk about, we can find out whether compositions are in equilibrium or not, right? So suppose we have n components. How many phases are there in this particular system?
Two.
How many phases?
Two.
Two phases. So what should be the minimum number of properties that I should know in order to completely define the state of this particular vapor liquid mixture comprising of n components? Can you tell me?
N
number. Fine. So for the timing, suppose we take again the simplest thing, binary mixture. So therefore, the minimum number of components that we have to know are two. So if we know two components, we should be in a position to find out all other components. Yes or no? What are the different variables? You tell me. T is one, P is one, X one is there one. Definitely, if you know X one, X two will be equal to one minus X one. So I am not considering X two as a variable. And Y one is there. If you know Y one, you can always find out Y two. Right. So therefore, for completely defining a binary mixture, either your T and P has to be given and X1, Y1 has to be found out. Or maybe P and X1 has to be given, T and Y1 has to be found out. This can also be one part. Or else it's just X1, Y1 is given, you can find out TP. Right. Now, normally all these equilibrium data, they are collected either at constant temperature or at constant pressure. So for most of the cases, you will find that either this is given, this has to be found out, or maybe PY1 is given, TY1 has to be found out. Sorry, this is TX1. Okay, so for most of the cases, we find either PX1 is given, you have to find out TY1. TX1 is given, you have to find out PY1. These are the most common things, or else can the reverse, TY1 is given this or PY1 is given, you have to find this out. Okay, so therefore what we are going to do tomorrow is, we are going to take up some particular ideal solutions. We are going to do problems because just discussing is not going to help. Okay, so please be ready with your calculators tomorrow. What we are going to do is, I will be giving you, or rather we can take up any particular ideal solution. Say if you can take up a benzene toluene mixture, or we can also take up a hexane heptane mixture, any particular type of mixture we can take up, and we can try to find out one set of components provided the others are given. There is one particular problem which I can suggest to you. Say suppose I take up a, just think about this problem so that tomorrow when you come, say maybe a pentane heptane problem, right? This conforms to the ideal solution behavior. We know about it. This conforms to the ideal solution behavior. So therefore, if I tell you that find out the pressure at 70 degrees centigrade for X pentane equals to say 0.1, or maybe I can P at 70 degrees centigrade, X pentane equals to 0.1. Can you proceed to do this? I have given you temperature, I have given you composition. Two things are already known to you. Can you find out the pressure as well as the Y pentane? How do you proceed? Think about it. Tomorrow we are going to discuss these things and we are going to complete ideal solutions. Then we will see how to change the ideal with minimum possible botheration, how we can modify the ideal solution model to conform, or rather to predict non-ideal behaviors. So till whatever I have done till now, I believe it's clear to you. Anybody, anything which you want that I should be discussing it once more tomorrow? And since you are recording, I do not think I need to send whatever I have. Five board is pretty dirty, so there's no point in sending that. Yeah, anything you think you wish that I need to discuss tomorrow, once more it will be clear. Sneha wanted to say yes.
Ma'am, there is one request, ma'am.
Yes, please.
Ma'am, the third assignment, the deadline is 25, ma'am. Can you extend it by one more day? Because there's Manish's test also.
Manish's test for what? Thermodynamics?
Yes, ma'am.
When is he taking it?
He is taking it on 26. So I'm left with some questions. So if I get one more day, so I will do it then.
I see. But the portions, I'll talk with him. Okay, those portions he can cover after I finish. Let me see. Okay, so Manish's class test is on when? 26th?
Yes, ma'am.
And is he taking extra classes now?
No, ma'am, his syllabus is covered. No, but ma'am. He's taking test on 26th.
I see. But has he covered chemical reaction equilibrium? That has not been covered, I believe. Is it?
No, ma'am. He said he will cover after your part will be completed.
Okay, fine. I have no problem. So Manish's test is on when? 26th.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
When was the assignment date? 25th.
Yes, ma'am.
But the assignments, they were not difficult, isn't it? I can extend it by one day, but is it going to help you?
On 25th also we have a test.
See, my problem is very simple. I can definitely extend it by a day. That's not a big deal. But the only thing is, I don't think that's going to help you much. Anyhow, you want it to be extended. It was 25th. You want to extend it to 26th. The only problem is the semester is ending. So after this, the assignments for ideal solutions, again, will be getting a little less time. So that you decide, because again, then in that case, you are going to get just 3-4 days time. So will it be fine for you at that time?
Yes, ma'am.
Because the moment I finish it tomorrow, I'll be giving you assignments on ideal solutions. Okay. So therefore, if you are finishing this on 26th, then that assignments you have to submit by Tuesday. There, because again, after that, non-ideal solutions are going to come. So therefore, I cannot extend it further. Okay. So is that fine for you?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
I am, but be very sure, all of you, that you will be getting lesser time to do assignments on ideal solutions and also non-ideal solutions. So if you are fine with that, I have no problems.
Yes, ma'am, we are fine, ma'am.
No, but this is only Sneh and Bhavna speaking. What about the rest? Is everybody fine? Not with?
Yes, ma'am. Yes,
this
ma'am.
Assignment date. But yes, remember, ma'am, one thing. The other two assignments have to be done in 1 week. Are you fine with that? Definitely in that week you have some holidays, but then also. Because by
yes, ma'am.
Tuesday morning, yes, ma'am, I want the assignments of ideal solutions.
Yes,
right? Fine for you. Okay, then. Then let me just note down this assignment. When do you want to submit? Can you just tell me? 26th is which day? 26th is Friday. Achha, you want to submit it? Friday, 12 noon, I'm putting it. Okay?
Midnight, ma'am.
Midnight, ma'am, okay. Please.
Then your midnight. Achha, wait, then ideal solutions have to be submitted by 30th. Just note down, because at 30th, okay? And non-ideal solutions, that is the end, that has to be submitted by 30th, 31st, 1st, 2nd, 3rd. Right? So therefore, just note down, if this is 12 midnight, I have no problems, then in that case, ideal solutions is 30th midnight and non-ideal solutions is 3rd midnight. This is fine for you?
Yes, ma'am.
But that time also you'll be having tests. Anyhow, if it's fine, I'll go to do it. Tomorrow just be prepared, because see, every class just teaching. I felt that at least one, I don't know how well the tutorial class I can conduct, but I felt yes, to tomorrow's class there should be something like a tutorial so that you're doing in the class. I do not know, because I would just expect that all of you will be doing it honestly and we can discuss it out. Okay, so tomorrow the entire ideal solution, whatever I'll be teaching, they'll be in the form of problems so that you can do it, you can report to me, and we're going to finish up ideal solutions definitely by tomorrow. Okay, I am anyhow running short of time, so that non-ideal we can start on Friday. Come prepared with the calculators tomorrow so that you can also do certain things and then you can participate in the discussions. Okay?
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you, all of you. I request just the TAs to stay back, please, for 5 minutes.
Hello, ma'am.
Yes, please.
Ma'am, students, please check assignment 2 solutions uploaded in file section.
And there is one other request, possibly all of you, please upload all your assignments in specifically the folders which are assigned, okay? Otherwise, it becomes difficult. I also don't want all of you to suffer, okay? So all of you can leave. The TAs, please stay back for 4 minutes, for 5 to 10 minutes. All the TAs kindly stay back. The others can leave.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. So now you're happy, isn't it?
Yes, ma'am.
So who is there? Pranita is there. Bipin is there. Acha, Farin and Vipin, what about the ideal solution assignments? When are you giving it to me?
Ma'am, by tomorrow.
Tomorrow, perfect. So,
yes.
So ma'am.
Yes, tomorrow.
Is this Vipin?
Yeah. Ma'am, by yes, this week, I have submitted that.
That is the problem. I have kept it. We are going to see it. Definitely, we are going to consider. We are going to go through it. But at the moment, you will not get your marks. Let us just see that. Because see, certain things have to be maintained. So definitely, I'll consider it. But I have kept it on hold. The TAs are going to go through it. But we'll also see your other assignments, etc. And then finally, your marks will be given. Okay?
Thank you, ma'am. Sure, ma'am.
Achha, Vipin and Farin. So, ideal solutions I'm getting by tomorrow, isn't it?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Achha, next Acha, non-ideal, several things you have already given in your previous assignments. So few more problems on non-ideal solutions. And let me tell you, for non-ideal solutions, it will just be Vanlar and Margulis, three suffix Margulis and three suffix Margulis. We are not going to go for Wilson and all those blah blah. Okay. So just on these very straightforward problems, you can set for non-ideal solutions. So non-ideal solutions, when can I expect from you?
Yes, ma'am.
Ma'am, by Saturday.
By Saturday. Day after tomorrow. Will it not be too tight?
Okay, ma'am. Day after tomorrow.
By Sunday, you send the non-ideal solutions to me. Okay, take some time. Non-ideal. See, one thing, let me tell you. On Friday, when I do non-ideal, you'll be understanding. Okay. On Wednesday, possibly I'll be finishing non-ideal solutions. Okay. So not before Wednesday, I'm uploading them. So on Friday, you'll get some idea. On Wednesday, you'll get some idea. So therefore, after Friday, maybe Sunday or Monday, sometime you decide, you give it to me. I'm going to upload it only on Wednesday after I finish off everything. On Thursday, we'll be having maybe some revision, and on next Wednesday, we'll have a test, and that is it. Right. Acha, Pranita, immediately what I want from you is the list of the students who have been consistently absent, because I do not know whether their net connection.
I have mailed you that. I have mailed you that list.
When? Just now or earlier?
Like during the class, I mailed you.
Acha, then I have not checked. Okay. Yeah. So the students who have been consistently absent or have attended very less class, isn't it?
Like, yeah, who've attended two or three classes from nine classes.
Nine. Acha, and no classes?
Yeah, there are two students who haven't attended any.
And how many students who have attended only one or two classes?
Like there are about 17 or 18 in the list who have attended two or three classes.
I'll take care. Thank you very much. Otherwise, Pranita and Pallavi, you have seen the assignments. You have no other work at the moment. Maybe at the final... When the final test is there, that time it's again going to be a 1 hour test. Yeah. Not so that time you have to check. Otherwise, for the time being, you just go through the assignments and then go through the classes. That is it. Okay.
Yeah.
Nice.
Okay.
Acha, Pallavi, one thing I was thinking, I do not know. See, the Pranita and Vipin, you can leave for the time. Pallavi, what I was thinking is that I do not know when you will be allowed to come. So I was just talking because I'll be starting the MOOCs lecture for process equipment design. Okay. So that's why I was thinking I'll need Bonusri and possibly you. So if you are permitted, then maybe you can come off a little earlier, and Farin will come when the due permission comes up. Okay. I'll see if I can get something by which Farin can be brought a little earlier. I'm not very hopeful at the moment, the way things are moving. But I'll try. But Pallavi, possibly for Pallavi and Bonusri, I can tell that they are going to be TAs for my PED. Anyhow, I need TAs, and accordingly, then you can come. But in that case, you have to do the TA duty for the MOOCs. It's of course a paid job, but anyhow, you have to do the TA duty of the MOOCs, and then you can start your work also.
Okay.
Is it fine for you?
Okay.
But do not be too optimistic. I really do not know if they are going to give permission. I'm going to try it out. Okay.
Okay. Ma'am, one request from my side and Farin side, ma'am. Actually, we are suffering with a CMRF project, ma'am. That deadline should be April 14th April, ma'am. So can we get permission for not attending multi-phase flow lab classes, ma'am? At least up to 14, ma'am. Then we will start again.
Wait, I did not understand. What is it? I could not follow. What is it?
Actually, we have a subject of CMRF, ma'am.
What is
so, hello?
What is this? CMRF?
Ma'am, that is computational fluid dynamics for multi-phase flow reactors.
You're attending the class. Acha. So, till 14th, you do not want to attend the meet, multi-phase flow meet, is it?
Yes, ma'am.
Perfect. That can be granted, but Pallavi, possibly you have to. Yeah, I'll try that. You can come off at the earliest, because I need start the recording at the earliest.
Okay.
We have to do an RT-PCR and we have to come off. Because after coming also, there will be a 7 days or 14 days quarantine. I don't know.
Okay,
ma'am.
Okay.
All the best.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay. So, yeah, but this thermal dynamics will go on, but you don't want to attend the lab meet. That is fine. You can attend after. Okay?
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.